And now we have this next word, resist the devil. Okay, this is another military term. It's another aorist imperative, which means do it, complete it, do it now. Do it once and for all. He's saying resist the devil. Now this is a military term. If you're told to resist, which means what? You are now resisting. You are not submitting to the devil. You are not obeying the devil. You are resisting the devil. It's a military term. The same way that he says a military term to submit yourselves, therefore, to God, he's saying resist the devil. Same thing. It's a military term. Well, if you have to resist the enemy, what do you need to do? You're in formation. You need to do what you need to do because the enemy does not need to come another step further. And you need to reclaim surrendered ground. Take back what Satan has stolen from you. Resist the devil. That's what he's saying. Do it. Submit yourself, therefore, to God. Resist the devil. And then what does it say? And he will flee from you. He will flee from you. I don't know anybody who ever tells me the devil flees from them. There's a reason. Because we're not resisting. We're not resisting. Well, how do you resist? Well, I bind you, Satan, and all that. You know, is that are we told to do that in the Bible? No, who can bind Satan? Jesus. He's strong. The only one who can bind the strong man is the one who is stronger. That's Jesus. I mean, I've heard all these different things on prayer, same as you. Well, you know, whatever you got to pray for, you're going to, you know, make sure that you start from the top down. You got to, you know, bind Satan, and then all the other demons and every all the principalities that are under him have to also submit to you. You know, when Jesus sent out the 12 and the 70, he also gives us authority to cast out demons. So part of that is true, but we make it a thing as though we're a somebody. But what did Jesus say to the disciples when they came back? You know, and they said they were all excited because these demons were leaving people. They were casting out demons in Jesus' name. And Jesus says, you know, don't be so excited that the demons are obeying you. But be excited that your name is written in heaven. Don't be excited about something. Why? Because we're just Jesus' agents. It's not us trying to clean up this planet of all those demonic strongholds out there. But we have responsibility from God to do so, to spread the kingdom of Jesus. So we resist the devil. Well, I'm calling out Marxism in our country because it's our country is in a very brutal state. So I'm trying to give you the information because we still have the ability to vote in this country. And we can vote out people who do not represent biblical virtues or values. So we have some responsibility. There are certain things that we can do. When no one cares about the life of the unborn, it's all about women's rights. There is no debate for women's rights. Well, what about the unborn woman? How come you're taking away her rights by killing her while she's still in her mommy's belly? What's the matter with you people? There's some resisting we can do. And where resistance is continuing, the devil has to flee. God gave us some amazing blessings in America, and we're just going to sit passively by it. It's stolen from us. There's some resisting we can do. I'm not telling you got to bury all kinds of weapons and ammunition in your backyard, but the things that we can do. How do you resist the devil? By being obedient to the laws that you do have. By being obedient to the truth that you know. By taking full, the full advantage of what God gives us. And he gives us everything we need for life and godliness. We have everything we need for our life here and for the ability to give God glory, to worship God with the way we live our life. We have everything we need. And by not using it, it would be like going to war. Oh, I guess I forgot my ammunition. Maybe I'll hold up my gun and try to intimidate somebody. No, you better have what you need if you're going to go to war. But it's not only that. We've got all of God's word, which is nonstop, powerful ammunition against the devil and all of his forces. But we also have something else. We can call for reinforcements. We can pray. When we pray, what's happening? God can send his ICBMs to the enemy's camp. Or have a little drone and drop a little missile on somebody, some bad guy's car. Whatever the case may be, that's prayer. If you could, like, push a button and make the bad guy stop it, wouldn't you do it? It's called prayer. The devil is a god of this age, and he's blinded the eyes of all the unbelievers. They don't know the truth. They can't even figure out the truth. You know, there's a bunch of scientists now who are realizing, okay, there must be a designer because, you know, evolution just doesn't work. It can't happen. It can't be reproduced. You know, genetics has just blown away every concept of evolution. But they still hold tight to evolution. Just because they have all this knowledge, it doesn't mean that they're saved. You have to be obedient to the truth that you know. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. You know what the easiest way to resist the devil? Disobey him and obey Jesus. Very simple. I mean, it's not about, you know, casting out anybody or binding anybody or shouting and carrying on and all these crazy things. It's about if the devil is lying to you about the character of God and he starts magnifying reality, what do? You magnify Jesus. Start reading the songs. Start filling your mind with who God really is. Start encouraging yourself in the Lord. David will teach you how to do it. All you got to do is read the Psalms right off the page. This is how he did it. You start seeing God as he really is. It's resisting the devil. You know, we get bad days. Bad days aren't there because we're in pain. Bad days aren't there because we're sick. Bad days aren't there because of inconvenience. Bad days are there because we're listening to demonic lies as he is fanning into flame all the things that we should think that we ought to be having, or magnifying the reality of what does hurt and what is inconvenient. Why do we have a bad day? It's all in here. Because we're meditating on something demonic. That's why we're in a bad mood. That's why we're angry. That's why we're bitter. Or we could magnify God. We can submit to God. As we do that, we are resisting the devil. We're being obedient to God. We know what to do. Just do it. It's not about being in agreement. Well, I'm kind of tired, you know, I don't really want to pray, or I'm kind of tired, you know, and, you know, I don't think I can hardly even see God's word, much less read it. The reason why you're tired is because you ran out of ammunition earlier in the week. You have to, you know, if you don't eat, you're going to get tired. Well, we're spiritually tired because we're spiritual anorexics. We're not in the Word. What are we filling our mind with? What are we listening to? Anybody can lie to you. Friends can lie. Family can lie. TV can lie. Radio can lie. But demons can lie to you. So you have to get the truth and let the spirit of truth take the truth right off the page and now help you magnify the Lord with his own words. You know, you can read the Psalms and you can tell God exactly what prayers he wants to hear because the Holy Spirit inspired them and we can just read them off the page. If you don't know what to pray, just start praying what David already prayed. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Well, there's all kinds of stuff that talks about in, you know, Ephesians chapter 6 about putting on the full armor of God because we don't wrestle against flesh and blood. And if we're mad at flesh and blood, we believe the demonic lie because they're not the ones doing it. They just happen to be his agents. It's what's behind them that's doing it. The accuser of the brethren. If we want to start accusing somebody, we're becoming Satan's agent. We start saying something bad about somebody, we'll get into that in the next section. We're becoming Satan's agent of the accuser of the brethren. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. The Bible says it's a promise. That's what happens. So how are you going to resist the devil? Don't listen to what you heard. Don't listen to the thoughts in your mind. Turn off everything and get in God's word. You know, a lot of people, well, I'm just praying and it's not helping. There's a reason. You're not in the word. Because you can pray all kinds of stuff and it's just the thoughts in your mind and they're going to be infused with all kinds of stuff you've already heard, stuff from the world system. It comes in from all different kinds of places. You're going to start obsessing over somebody not thinking the way you want them to think about you. I mean, all those things are going to go in your head when you pray. Or just get into the word and let God, the Holy Spirit, speak right directly to you. Now you're actually empowered to go push that little ICM button against the devil as he's coming against you. You got to get in the word. Resist the devil and he'll flee from you. Verse 8, draw nigh to God and he will draw nigh to you. Draw nigh to God. Now, a lot of the ways that word draw nigh, which means you come to God. Well, are you going to come to God if you're in sin? No, you're going to be ashamed of yourself in God's presence. You're not going to want to do it. I mean, really, if you're doing something, you know God says no. You're not going to want to draw nigh to God. And there's a lot of people who don't want to draw nigh to God. You know, well, I know I should draw close to God. Well, I really want to start serving God, you know, and all kinds of fun things. Well, they're not willing to be obedient to the truth that they already know. So they're going to pray and nothing's happening. Why? Because their prayers are just this miscellaneous hodgepodge of all kinds of stuff in their head. And they're not in the word. The word is convicting them of sin. The word is showing them where they are being disobedient to God, where they're doing things that God says he doesn't like. Draw nigh to God. That phrase in the Greek for draw nigh is the same word that's used for worship. Mm-hmm. Well, if you're going to worship God, you're going to have to worship him, right? You're going to give him worth. You're going to give him what's due him for being God. And it's not about singing the songs you like to sing. Because God won't accept worship from someone who is planning to or is involved in unrepentant sin. He won't accept it. I told you what the sacrifices of God that he accepts. A broken and a contrite spirit. That's what he accepts. Broken heart. Humility before him. That's what he accepts. Draw nigh to God. Which means you're going to come with all your yuck on you. And you're going to say, Lord, you see what the mess I am. Please forgive me. Please have mercy on me. That's a state of humility. You're not, okay, God, I know you can use a guy like me. Pretty sick to even think about. Draw nigh to God. Well, when you draw nigh to God, if you truly come into God's presence, you walk in the light as he is in the light, which means you're going to be honest before him and people. You're going to have fellowship with other people who are genuine Christians. It's the blood of Jesus that cleanses you from all your sin. We need the blood of Jesus cleansing us. He wants to do that. We confess our sins. He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That is drawing near to God. We draw near to him. It's giving him what is due him. It's giving him the worship that is due him. Draw near to God and he will draw nigh unto you. Well, there's a promise there. People don't want to come to God because they're in sin and they know God doesn't like it. And they got a big problem trying to draw near to God in their life. But when you draw nigh unto God, you draw nigh to God, truly coming to God with everything that you are, he knows everything anyway. Just say what he says. Confession means humble. His Greek word is homologeo. Say what God says. Mm-hmm. Call sin what he calls sin. Mm-hmm. Call it out in your life to God. And he's faithful and just to forgive your sin and purify you from all unrighteousness. You draw near to God and he will draw near to you. You know, there is the parable that Jesus gives of the rich man, you know, the Pharisee and the publican. You know, so the Pharisee is praying to himself, it says. He basically says, you know, thank God for making me such a gall darn nice guy, doing all these great things for you. Especially better than that character over there. And who was the character over there? Well, that was a publican. He was a tax collector. And what did he say? He said, Lord, have mercy on me, the sinner. The sinner. I'm the sinner here. I know it. But the word for have mercy is an interesting word. It's the word for mercy seat. It's the word propitiation. It's the word that John uses in John 2:2. First John chapter 2, he says, I write these things unto you, brethren, so you don't sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Christ Jesus, the righteous. Mm-hmm. And he is the propitiation for our sins. He is the mercy seat that the blood would have been dripped on the Day of Atonement. He is the propitiation. He takes God's wrath in our place. He is a propitiation for our sins, and not our sins only, also the sins of the whole world. Mm-hmm. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Oh, so that means everybody gets to go to heaven? Uh-huh. No, only those who have faith. If someone doesn't believe, they stay in condemnation. It's right there after John 3:16. Very clear. You don't have to come up with all kinds of crazy ways of taking it. No, it's right there. Just read it off the page. Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. And he says, cleanse your hands, ye sinner, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Well, James had already used this word double-minded before, you know. And he doesn't receive anything in prayer because he's double-minded. He doesn't receive anything. Why? Because he's thinking, well, maybe this, well, maybe that. Well, I don't want to do this. Well, I don't know for sure if God's going to do that or not. It's like, no, don't even have any expectations God's going to answer that prayer because you're double-minded. So here he says, cleanse your hands, ye sinners. Well, what does that mean? Well, he's made this picture of what temple worship truly looks like. You're drawing nigh to God, which means what? If there's something that you have done wrong, you need to take that sacrifice that will take care of that thing that you've done wrong. You draw nigh to God, God will draw nigh to you. Now he says, cleanse your hands. You have to be in a state of ceremonial cleanness. That's kind of from the outside. Well, in a spiritual sense, you know, we're not walking around trying to stay kosher and not, you know, all those kinds of things. Cleanse your hands means it's not just, okay, clean hand, whatever. It means you're not doing things that you know are sin. You're staying away from known sin. There are certain activities and behaviors and mindsets and all these things that you know are sin. And from the outside, you're not going to do that. There, you know, even a person in a 12-step program knows to stay away from the people, places, and things. And they're unbelievers. What about us? We're believers. Are we going to stay away from the people, places, and things? I mean, that's the idea of cleansing your hands. Do on the outside what you know to do. And then it says, and purify your hearts. That means take it truly seriously and be changed. Be transformed by God's word. Truly take seriously when God calls out some kind of sin. And that's purifying the heart. The heart, we can understand it as like the seat of emotions, right? Okay? Those things, how we feel. And it's kind of the idea of what we take our identity in, kind of the way we look at the soul, you know, our mind, will, and emotions. Do you want in your life what God wants? Do you like in your life what God likes? Do you want to pursue what God wants you to pursue? Is your identity in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ just like you said it was when you got baptized? Or is your identity being something else? How do you dress? Are you dressing to show a special identity to somebody? Or is your identity in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ? Mm-hmm. We take the Lord's Supper. And Paul says, you know, we proclaim the Lord's death until we return. It's a constant reminder that Jesus had to suffer and die on the cross in our place in order for us to be restored in relationship to God. It's a constant reminder of that. And it starts off, you know, very simply, on the night that he was betrayed. I mean, you couldn't set up the words in a more clear, dramatic sense. So he says, okay, cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. If you know, Amos 3:3, the Lord says to Remus, can two walk together unless they be agreed? If you've got a different agenda from God, you're going this way, and he's going that. Can two walk together? Oh, it's fun to see people walking, holding hands. But that's because they're in agreement at that period of time while they're holding hands. Well, you walking, holding hands with Jesus. It goes right back to those people who want what the world wants, who love what the world loves, and he calls them adulterers and adulteresses. Well, you can shine, you know, your girlfriend, your boyfriend on, hold their hand, you know, as long as they're with you, but is that truly walking hand in hand with them? Well, are we agreed with God? Well, when God, how are we going to know? Because we're going to have a need. We're going to have a want. And what are we going to do? We're going to pray. And what are we going to do when God says no? Are we going to be humble and receive grace? Or are we going to set ourselves up as God's enemy and do it and get it our own way? Really, this is what he's saying. It's the context is very clear. Are we double-minded? Do we really want what God wants? Is Jesus really our commanding officer? Oh, you're praying, you're preaching Lordship salvation. You know, if Jesus isn't the Lord of your life, you really haven't received him as Savior. Because you don't know that you're a sinner in need of a Savior. It's as simple as that. If you're going to do things your own way, I don't think you really repented. Because if there's no evidence of conversion, yeah, your salvation really is suspect. You're just a false professor. Oh, are you trying to make people no longer having assurance of salvation? I want people to know for sure if they're saved or not. How are you going to know for sure? Well, go through the book of James. These are a whole bunch of tests. Are you saved or not? Look at 1 John. 1 John is a whole bunch of tests. Are you really saved or not? Well, how are we going to know? Are we in agreement with God? Well, I know there's a lot of us at different times of our life, every one of us a little bit spiritual immature, and we really, really want something God says no, and it really hurts. It does hurt when God says no. And for me, when God says no, or when I'm pursuing something and I got a whole bunch of, you know, emotional, you know, investment in something, and he says no, it's just like somebody pull the plug. Because it's a hurtful disappointment when he says no. So what am I going to do? Do it my own way? Or am I going to be quickly humble in order to receive the grace that I need? to be content in whatever that pain is, to be content in that inconvenience, to be content in that no. I need to be content in that no, because that's God's will. That means that I am submitting myself to God. I am under His direction. I am following His orders. I'm going to do what He says. And old orders are good as new orders. Just because I'm tired of the old orders, don't be weary in well doing. If you're not weary in well doing, you will receive reward. There is a reward waiting for the stuff that seems to be like unending, monotonous. No, there is reward. And we can receive the grace to continue on. Draw nigh to God, and He will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners. Purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Verse 9, be afflicted and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to heaviness. Well, this doesn't sound very fun. I mean, this doesn't sound very positive and encouraging. I mean, can we have fun in church? James says, be afflicted and mourn. Well, the idea of being afflicted is, remember when Daniel was given a prophecy and he wanted some understanding. So what did he do? He was fasting and he was praying. And he didn't get the answer right away. Well, the angel finally showed up to give him an answer. And he says, I was prohibited from, this demonic stronghold. I couldn't get you to you right away. But from the moment you prayed, God sent me. I mean, I don't know if God will ever send an angel and says, you're beloved of the Lord. I mean, that would be amazing. But Daniel had proved it by his whole behavior, that he was absolutely living that life. To be afflicted is basically not surrounding yourself with all the plush, nice pillows and all the things that make life easy and enjoyable. Being afflicted in the Old Testament means you're fasting. That's what it means in the Old Testament, to afflict yourself. Now, there was a day, the Day of Atonement, when they were to fast. And then they added more days to that. They fasted when the temple was destroyed and all those different times. They added different times, and then the Pharisees ended up fasting twice a week. I mean, they were, So anyway, that's the idea of being afflicted. It means not, don't give you everything you want, but not give you everything you want. Be afflicted. And when we are no longer practicing self-gratification, we can hear from God a whole lot easier. We get really addicted to self-gratification in a whole lot of ways. We always get what we want right away. And if we don't get it right away, now we're mad. I mean, we're so far away in the American church to understand what it means to be afflicted. No, it's not self-flagellating, like Luther did until he passed out or whatever. Anyway, be afflicted and mourn. That's the idea of sackcloth and ashes. Well, why are you going to mourn? Because you're mourning over the no that God just said. You're mourning over it, as opposed to you're mourning over the loss. You're mourning over the need. You're mourning over, if you're mourning according to God's will, there is absolutely going to be an answer of grace waiting for you. Be afflicted and mourn and weep. I mean, this is the kind of prayer that Daniel would have. That's the kind of prayer, afflicted and mourn and weep. That's a state of humility before God. Let your laughter be turned to mourning. Well, it's hard to do that when your whole life is filled with entertainment. I mean, really, it's like we Americans, we got always something in front of us trying to make us feel good. If it's music, if it's a game, if it's entertainment, if it's something, all these things are keeping us from hearing God. Keeping us from drawing nigh to God, keeping us from submitting ourselves to God. All these imperatives that are right here, we keep ourselves from even going there because we're constantly being self-entertained. And we don't want to live a life in our tent. I mean, what am I going to do if I don't have this, making me feel good? Now let your laughter be turned to mourning. there's mourning over your own sin. There's mourning over the consequences of your sin. There's mourning over a wasted life where you could have given more of your life to the service of the Lord. And, you know, mourning over the reward you could have gotten had you been, you know, living for God and not for yourself. But mourning is mourning over the state of lack of spirituality in your sphere of influence. Mourning over the fact that you haven't prayed for these people who are, you know, going to hell all around you. You know, there shouldn't be any unbeliever in our life that goes to hell without our hands of prayer holding onto their feet. You know what I'm saying? Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to heaviness. Are we heavy for the immorality? The amorality in our country? Are we mourning over the spiritual condition of our loved ones? Are we mourning over the spiritual condition of the church? Verse 10, humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord. That means you're not going to get the best of everything. That means you're choosing not to pay attention to yourself, but instead you're seeing God as he really is. And you're giving him the sacrifices that are due him. What it says in Hebrews, what sacrifices? The fruit of our lips, giving thanks unto God, giving him praise. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up. We can't lift ourselves up by our own bootstraps. We can get ourselves excited listening to some nice motivational speaker, but you know what? We can't accomplish it because we aren't in charge of the universe. No, there's one who's in charge of this world. He's the devil, and he's going to make our life a living hell. But if we humble ourselves in the sight of the Lord, Jesus is going to lift us up. It's not about us being the winner. It's not about us being proved right. It's not about us winning. It's about Jesus getting what is due him for his sufferings. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up. It's a nice song to sing, but I shouldn't want to sing that song because it doesn't really say anything. If we truly take it to heart, we're going to live submitting to one another out of the fear of the Lord because we have humbled ourselves in the sight of the Lord. If we haven't humbled ourselves in the sight of the Lord, then, you know, people are going to have to serve us. People are going to have to make us feel good about ourselves. James is saying, I want you to be mature spiritually. And these are some really hard words, some difficult words, because it goes down deep into each one of us. And each one of us know we haven't given God his due. We haven't given God what's due him. Not even close. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up. There was a guy who wanted to serve the Lord. And he finally got the opportunity. And he was put in charge of taking care of a bunch of the Hellenistic widows. So he was making sure that they didn't starve. So he was going from house to house of the widows who didn't grow up in Jerusalem and didn't have all the pedigree of, you know, being a good Jewess, but they came from some other country and there they were, but they got saved. They know that Jesus is their Savior, Jesus is Messiah, and they need to be taken care of. And so he got the job. So he was doing that, but you know, he couldn't help sharing his faith. And one time he had the opportunity to preach and talk to some of the folks that even put Jesus on the cross. And there he was, preaching in front of the people who needed to hear the truth of who Jesus was, that he was Messiah, that he's God the Son. And he's bringing out all the passages and Psalms and other places that really proclaim Jesus is God. He had humbled himself in the sight of the Lord. And now it was time for him to be lifted up. He got exalted. And he had this ability to speak in front of all these people. And what happened? They stoned him to death. Same with Stephen, the first Christian martyr. And as he was there under the crushing weight of all those boulders, he looked up and he saw Jesus standing at the Father's side. And he was received into heaven. That day in heaven, Jesus received his first crown, because Stephen's name means crown. Jesus received the first Christian martyr, someone who loved Jesus more than his own life. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up. And Stephen got to be with Jesus forever that day. And his body got covered over with boulders and rocks. What would be better? How do you want to live the rest of your life? Dealing with the warfare here or being with Jesus forever? Well, it was absolutely due Jesus for his suffering for him, and he knew it. Is that our mindset? Are we really, truly humbling ourselves in the sight of the Lord? Do we understand what Jesus has done for us? He who created us in his own image, he became a human being so that he could live the perfect life that we weren't willing to live, that we were incompetent of living. And then he suffered and died to be punished for every bad thing we could ever do. What is due him for his sufferings? Have we really humbled ourselves in the sight of the Lord? If we do, he will lift us up according to his will, according to his plan, in due time, whatever that means. And he's going to receive the glory for that too. Lord Jesus, we ask that you help us see things your way, dear God. We ask that you help us. Lord, we don't want to be idolaters, especially worshiping our own self. Lord, we want to give you the glory. Lord, you know that all of us have fallen short of your glory. But you are there in time of need, offering that mercy. And you continue to live to intercede for us. And if any of us do sin, we have you, Lord Jesus, as our advocate, because you are the propitiation for our sins and also the sins of the whole world. Lord, help us and use us to talk about the other sinners out there and let them know their need for a Savior and let them know who their Savior is, Lord. Because you want all men to be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth. That's what you want. Lord, we want to give you what you want. Lord, help us give you what you want by us being obedient to the truth that we know, being obedient to all of your teachings, Lord. We ask you to help us. In Jesus' name, amen.